Welcome to my channel. It's your girl Sharon, aka the Mel Nostalgic Runner, and we are back for another episode of review of the Real Housewives of Beverly Hills. This is season 14, and this is episode 3, and it's called Life as a Beach. And there's a couple takeaways I have from this episode, and in general, and I'm going to address it, and then we'll get more into the episode. Number one, if you're not watching the after show along with the show, you are truly missing out. Jennifer Tilly is a national treasure. Oh my gosh. Like, her narration and her view on the things that are going on, I laugh. Every single after show I've watched with her, I've been cracking up. Like, that dynamic duel, or actually the trifecta of Jennifer Tilly, Garcelle, and Sutton together, love it. Love it, love it, love it. That's one. Number two, Kyle is the problem. Just in case y'all didn't know, Kyle is the problem. She is a problem consistently in both situations. Because one thing that I will say, and this is kind of a 2 and 3 point, is I do find that what's going on between Kyle and Dorit is really paralleling what's going on in their actual relationships with their soon-to-be ex-husbands, in certain ways. I think all of them are wrong, but what gets me with Kyle, and it happened the last episode too, and I didn't mention it as much, Kyle is very much someone who, when she reads people on what's going on with them, it's really what's going on with her. When she says it's self-awareness, when she said last week that self-awareness is lacking for Dorit, that's her. That's actually the self-directness is lacking for Kyle. It is a little bit with Dorit, but not. I feel like it's crazy that Kyle somehow has me siding with Dorit. I never thought that would happen. I never thought I would be on the side of Dorit. And this season so far, I am on Dorit's side overall. And then the third thing, Garcelle, I need to understand something, and it's going to come up, but let's talk about it now, and then we'll go more into details of it. Why do you care what the conversation that Dorit is having with someone else, and you're not in it if you don't like Dorit? Respectfully, if I don't like someone, I'm not bringing you in my business. I'm going to have this outside conversation over here at the table. And then if I feel like addressing it with you, well, I will. And if I don't, I don't. The difference is at least she's having it on camera. We don't know what's going on with you and your personal outside of like your jobs. So, and I never thought I would say that, but I'm just like, Garcelle, like, I understand why you don't care for Dorit, because I was on your side with that. I'm still on your side when it comes to that. And I am still siding Dorit, even though Dorit and Bo seem like they're heading off to a good start. But I still got my good eye on her, because I hope that that friendship was not as calculated as it looks, because it looks calculated, because you're accused of some things. And man, if the chocolates of the chocolates woman who is a boss all of a sudden saves you, whoa, that helps a lot, doesn't it? With the talks of what has been said about you, Dorit. Don't think I forgot. I did not. But at the same time, Garcelle, back to you. I'm going to need you to, if you really don't care for this person, you need to give unbothered. AKA, I don't care what's going on over there. I will talk to Bose in my own time. It's that simple. You have a whole entire season where you can get to know and talk to Bose. Don't do what you did there. I was confused. We'll get to that when we get to it. But like, I just kind of want to get out the way and say it now, because it's fresh in my dome, and I don't want to make this review super long, because y'all know I'm well. Similar to Dorit, I am long-winded. So I want to make sure I got that point across right away. So Without further ado, let's get into the episode. And this episode did end as a to be continued. And so, point number four, Bravo. I hope this to be continued was worth it, because it's happening a lot on these shows, and I don't know if I like it. It's kind of giving lazy, because sometimes the to be continues are not needed. I would say a rule of thumb is do a to be continued twice a season. That's it. One kind of at the beginning, like you did already, and then one like a cliffhanger towards the end of the season. But like, you should not be doing the to be continued on a similar situation that you did to be continued with the first time. And that's literally what happened here towards the end. We'll get to that, but I kind of wanted to call that out as well so that we don't have to like rehash the point once we're there. Anyway, let's get into that review though. So first, we do have a little bit of the Housewives montage, and we have Jade, which is one of Garcelle's twin sons. The one who's not as vocal, the quiet one, the one who had the girlfriend last season. He is actually he's busting out of his shell, and he signed a modeling contract with LA Model, which I love this for Garcelle, because for those who know, and a lot of us know, especially if you're of a certain age, I'm an 80s girl, I'm an 80s baby. So I remember seeing Garcelle when I was a little girl, because I watched Coming to America, because she was like one of the flower girls on Coming to America. So, like, Garcelle has been in the industry acting and all that for a very long time. But before acting, she was a model. Like, she was always known for her looks. Which is why, side note, this is also the reason why a lot of us get on her when it comes to her fashions, because we're confused. Because, like, girl, we know you were a model, so why are your fashions not giving? Why do you not have a stylist that can style you appropriately? Because sometimes she'd be looking a hot mess for how beautiful of a woman she is, because she is gorgeous. Gorgeous Haitian queen. Love her. But I just love seeing this, because it was kind of a full circle moment that, like, now her son's going to be doing a similar thing, becoming a model. And maybe that'll lead to other things like acting, producing, similar to what, you know, Garcelle has going on, because I could totally see that, because he's a handsome young man. Anyway, so then we also see in this Housewives montage, Erica received a new car, and it looks like a sporty Porsche situation. I think it was a Porsche. And then speaking of Porsche, Kyle and Porsche, see how I put that in together? They are having lunch together, and they're discussing Mo going to Europe. Apparently he's probably going for business, I'm assuming, and they're wanting to know who's he bringing the family, how's that going. So what I am noticing we're getting this season so far is just how things have changed since their separation. Now I will say this, I really wish Kyle had self-awareness, because later on in this episode we're gonna see that self-awareness is just, she ain't got it. She really doesn't have it. And anyway, we'll get into that. So then from there, we do see that Kathy actually shows, she's actually planning a girl's getaway to Oceanside, California, which is like a beach town for those who don't know. And they're going to do like a beach vacation kind of weekend. And pretty roughly 2 hours away from Beverly Hills. And so Kathy being the eccentric one for those, I mean, we know this. Well, a lot of y'all don't. Well, I'm assuming a lot of you do. She's very eccentric. So one thing that she's doing is she was like, I am going to personally invite all the ladies. And she's doing it her own way. And she's like, by me personally inviting them, I'm saving in shipping. So that should have been a hint to you. She's not coming empty-handed with the invitation. So she ends up driving this Rolls Royce, like a convertible Rolls Royce, with her, I think it was her assistant that she has, all over Beverly Hills area, or that whole entire metro area of essentially LA, I would say. Because not all of them are in Beverly Hills. But they to drop off the invitations along with the gifts. And the gifts were, it was a gift. Like, it was like basically a little mini suitcase, like one of those nicer mini suitcases, personalized with a whole bunch of personalized stuff in the actual suitcase itself with the invitation on top. So it was actually quite cute. I would have loved it. Now, we had some complainers on the cast that didn't really love it all the way, but we'll get to that. Some of the complaints, I got it, but like the others, I'm like, oh my gosh, I can tell you're not a happy person. And we'll get to that, because that's another thing that I really want to talk about in this review, is there is a certain someone, Kyle, who clearly is exuded in misery on our television. I think that's the other reason why we're all sick of her. Because it's clear she's not a happy person, but we'll get there. Side note, if this is a channel, or if you are watching this review and you love Kyle, you may want to skip this review. I probably should have just told you that at the beginning, because I'm reading her for filth this episode. Just because I've seen enough. I'm kind of over her. I was over her last season. A lot of us were. But this season is just becoming too much. It's like, girl, you're accusing people of certain things when all this is really you. And I need you to actually go to an actual good therapist, because I don't know what you're telling the therapist for the therapist to not be clocking you with this, but you got some changes you got to be making. But anyway, so back to the Kathy Hilton thing. I got totally distracted. Kathy Hilton goes to Bose's house first. And Bose is so confused on what's going on. So she wasn't really complaining. She just had a lot of commentary for this, but she was cracking me up. So hers, maybe some people might have thought what she was doing was complaining. It wasn't. It was valid, because she's coming. She's a new housewife. So first season of this, and probably her first time dealing with Kathy Hilton. So she's like, I don't know what's going on. And if you're someone who never has watched the show, because one thing I will say about Bo so far, she does come off as someone who is not really, she seems like she fits in like a glove when it comes to this housewives. But I think the reason why she's so good is I don't think she's all the way really watched the show. Because if she did, I don't think her views on certain situations would be the same. It's kind of clear to me that I don't think she's watched the show. So she really is kind of coming in like, what is happening? Why is Kathy doing this? For us who've watched the show before, we're not surprised that Kathy would be doing any of this stuff, because this is very Kathy. But anyway, so she gets her suitcase and she's like, okay. And then later on, as they're getting ready and she saw that they have like bomb, like self-tanning stuff, that was the only thing she complained about, because hello. Bose is a beautiful chocolate woman. She doesn't need, the sun loves her. She doesn't need help with the sun. The sun loves her. And when I say Bose is that girl and she's beautiful and that skin is skinning, that's all I'm going to say. But that was the only thing I would say that she complained about. By the way, I'm skipping around this review just in case y'all didn't know. But anyway, after her, next was Garcelle. She drops off the things to Garcelle. And Garcelle actually got to see the whole setup, though. She went outside and saw that she was riding this Rolls Royce, had her pillows. She's like, oh my gosh, this is so you, Kathy. But we already know Garcelle and Kathy, they're friends. So she wasn't surprised by any of this. So she's like, okay. But it was nice too, because Kathy kind of got to see Garcelle's son working, and we got to see a little bit of it too. So that was nice. Next, then she goes to Dorit's to drop it off, and Dorit is being Dorit. When I mean she's being Dorit, she's calling it chic, she's calling it fabulous. She's saying it will match my Chanel that I have, which we see later on, which becomes a problem later on. And we'll talk about that when we get there. But, and she's modeling the hat around. And side note, I didn't describe this hat, but the hat is like this beach hat that kind of has like a little, it is giving a little bit of like a lampshade type situation. But So it's not something I would necessarily wear for like the beach. On the after show, Erica mentioned it, and I agree with her. She wears it for gardening because it actually is a good sunblocker hat. It is a very good functioning sunblocker hat. It looks like it will do the job to block the sun while you're outside. So it just isn't the most fashionable, in my opinion. I personally wouldn't wear it. But also, too, I have a big head. And Erica even mentioned when she was trying it on, she's like, this does not work for my big head. My head's bigger than hers, so I don't see how it'll work. But maybe you get personally sized, but I still don't think I will look right in that kind of a hat. But anyway, so after Dorit gets her things, she goes to Kyle next. And then Kyle, this whole entire time, and I will say this too, just as a whole, every single time Kyle has been the confessional, and it really started probably two seasons ago, but it's gotten so much worse. Is it just me or is she always complaining? It's never positive. And it's not like reads. It's not like a read. It's not even something. A lot of times it's snarky, but it's not even funny snarky. It's giving cringe snarky and miserable snarkiness and a hater. Like that's her energy she exudes on the screen. And so even when like Kathy's giving her these things and getting her ready and trying to cheer her up, she has all these snarky remarks to say. I'm like, girl. And then she just kept calling the hat a lampshade, which I will say that I do agree with Kyle. It kind of does look like a lampshade, but I would never, if this was my sister giving me a hat and trying to put a trip together to bring us together and help, you know, solve problems, I wouldn't be this way. But also Kyle is like all on the whole idea that Sherry has a negative thought on how this is going to go because her and Dorit are still not good. But like the reason why her and Dorit are still not good is because of her. Okay. Mainly, in my opinion, it's her. If she would actually let Dorit have a voice, which I think that is part of Dorit's problem even when it comes to her relationship with PK, is her voice be lacking. That's why whenever she does get a chance to talk, she's long-winded. We know people like that. Side note, we know people like that. I'm not a Dorit stan. I'm not even a Dorit fan. But this season, I am understanding a little bit more where Dorit's coming from. And I've watched enough of the show to realize, okay, Dorit's long-winded, but people who are long-winded like that, they're like that because they don't feel like they're ever being heard. And in her case, You see how PK has treated Dorit throughout the years on this show. Do you think she was hurt in that relationship? Even how things transpired in this episode, do you think she feels like she has a voice in that relationship? If the answer is no, then you are correct. And so I think Dorit is at the point where she truly is fed up. And whether we believe that Dorit and PK are getting divorced or not, which I actually kind of starting to really believe it because I think PK is just over Dorit. I don't think, clearly Dorit didn't want it, but PK wants it because he thinks that he's going to have a similar kind of situation as Mauricio, forgetting the fact that Mauricio's fine and he ain't. Like, and Mauricio's money, he doesn't. Or if he does have money, the money's funny and, well, I was going to say, well, Mo's could be kind of funny-ish too. Both of them have some weird cases. So then, after that, back to Kyle. Kyle's talking to, the reason why I brought up Kyle. So Kyle's talking to Kathy, basically still coming up with reasons, excuses why her and Dorit are not good. Because now she added another reason. She added because of the fact that Dorit did not stand up to Alexander Rogers at BravoCon. So another BravoCon reason. And every single time there's a new reason. But then now Kyle's trying to say there's so many little reasons. Whereas Dorit, on the other side, later on, when Dorit FaceTimes Erica, Dorit has all the instances of why she's mad, but there, it's very concise. The timeline is timelining. It makes sense. Kyle's doesn't. Kyle's is giving, I am still reaching and grasping for straws. And even Dorit says in her after show, it comes off like Dorit, like literally she's grasping for straws. And even Erica on the after show, even though she's sitting next to Kyle, she is trying to like use the notes that she took from her ex-husband to find any way to give Kyle something. But she's even running out of things to defend it. It's like, Kyle, girl, get your storyline together. Get the timeline together. Or just be honest and say the real reason why you have a problem with her instead of this BS. Because we know it's some BS. You've been trying to ice her out. We saw you're trying to ice her out last season. And you're trying to act like you weren't trying to ice her out last season. And, oh, and then she keeps bringing up the reunion and revealing the text message. Even though your behavior towards Dorit started at the beginning of last season. And she acts like we forgot about that. It's like, I can't stand when a gaslighter tries to gaslight everybody. And she is a gaslighter. Anyway, so as all this is going on, Kathy's in her confessional being the voice of reason. But she's also still putting a pacifier and pacifying Kyle. Because she, of course she's going to. She's, you know, Kyle's big sister. And she's like, you know, although these things, they are so little, probably wouldn't have bothered her 3 or 4 years ago. But they are now because she is in a vulnerable state. But it's just like, I get that. And I think Kathy's trying to be neutral just like Erica's trying to be neutral. Neither want none to do with it. Because for obvious reasons, it just doesn't make sense to get involved. But anyway, that's pretty much all that happens here. Let's go on to the next thing, because I could continue to rant and rave about Kyle and her BS, because I cannot stand when someone tries to piss on me and tell me it's raining. And that is what Kyle's trying to do to all of us is watching. And I'm not with it. Before all that happened, so before all the ladies arrive at Kathy's house, Kyle and Mo actually went to Kyle's house, and they were talking about how are things going. She was talking about how she's redecorating the home and all that. And Kyle, this is where my conclusion of Kyle being just miserable really was there. It was like, oh, no, she's so miserable. She's such a miserable person. And because I think what she thought was going to happen, because what we keep forgetting, a lot of us forgot, but I'm here to remind you. Kyle's the one who asked for the separation. It wasn't Mauricio. It was Kyle. So now she's upset that Mauricio is literally living his best life without her. He's like, okay, well, you said it's done. Like, forgetting the fact that she was literally scissoring with, oh, girl, last season. It's like, girl, you're flaunting your whole entire Let's Be Honest relationship last season, and now you're upset that Mauricio, who we all know looks good, is living his best life and basically kind of midlife crisising. You are midlife crisising too. Sorry. He clearly was doing it better than you. Because what is triggering her is that Mauricio actually signed a 6-month lease, which basically means it's more permanent. And he also brought all the furniture in the house. He did not like stage it or buy an already furnished place. So it does come off like, okay, if you're done, I'm done too. Because I think she was expecting him. And this is where I'm doing the parallels between Kyle and Mo and Kyle and Dorit. She expects everyone to crawl back to her and coddle to her and basically treat her like a baby. And everyone is sick of doing that, clearly. No one's doing that. And so now she's miserable because nobody is doing that. No one's kissing the ring, if you will. And anyway, we also find out in this scene that Kyle has been contacting PK a lot, which, girl, that's weirdo behavior. why are you contacting someone that you are beefing with regularly? Why are you doing that? You don't think that looks kind of funny in the light? That looks a little weird. So she's doing that. And this is where how she finds out that PK's place is furnished. And this whole entire time, Kyle just continues to come off as very unaware. And it's a very cringe scene because she's just clearly annoyed at Mo being happy. Because she's no longer part of his happiness. He actually looks happier than ever being without her. And she can't take it. That's what's happening. Anyway. So next, we have a couple things happen here. So we have another little bit of a mini Housewives montage where we see Erica, Bo Sutton, and Jennifer Tilly getting ready for the weekend getaway. And then this is where we see Dorit FaceTiming Erica. And this is where I mentioned the receipts proof timeline. Dorit has them in comparison to Kyle. And really, to be honest, Dorit has the most valid reason to be upset with Kyle, and Kyle really doesn't have any reasons to be mad at her, for real. And if she does, she needs to say it, because none of us are understanding what she's mad at her about, for real. Because none of the reasons she's mentioned so far validate her being upset. Even the text message thing, Dorit, because Dorit actually has a reason to be upset about that, because it was like, that came off very manipulative, what Kyle did. But she's trying to uno reverse it and make it seem like, I'm mad at that because you shared it with the world. Even though if she wouldn't have shared it with the world, basically, Dorit would continue to be Kyle's flunky. And I think Dorit is sick of being Kyle's flunky. That's all it is. I'm just excited to see how the rest of the season's going to transpire, because I think the other girls are going to get sick of it. I think Garcelle's probably going to be the only one that sides with her at the end, for the most part, because Garcelle, for how much you don't like Dorit and understand you don't like her, you know, putting energy into not liking someone and doing things to spite them, that's hatred, but hatred and love, they're the same language. To be truly unbothered, you have to be indifferent. And until you understand the art of that, it's just not gonna, it's not gonna sit well with me. I'm like, girl, if you really want to be done with Dorit and how you feel about her, and you really don't like her like that, don't entertain her. Okay? I mean, hello? Anyway. I told you I was going to get on Garcelle a little bit this episode, because I am kind of getting sick of her. I'm getting sick of Garcelle and her no storyline behind. Like, I love her. I do. I love seeing her career stuff and all that. But at the same time, I don't need Kyle does not need assistance of gaslighting us. I'm sorry. I'm just saying. Anyway, so then next we have Bose arriving first at Kathy's house, then Dorit, then Bose is narrating. I was cracking up. I honestly did not know I needed this for a Housewives show. I want Bose to narrate everything when it comes to this season, because her narrating things, I was cracking up. She's like, last time I was with all these ladies, the girls were fighting. Are we going to fight again? Are the rest of the girls going to start fighting? Am I going to start fighting? I was like, I cackled when she said that. I was like, girl. And then next, Kyle arrives, then Erica, then Sun Garcelle, and then Jennifer. Everybody's there. Erica narrates a little bit. It's time to get it popping. It's time to go. So on the way to the trip, they're in like a Sprinter van drinking their champagne. And oh, the reason why Erica was narrating and the reason why I called it out is because Jennifer Tilly shows up with like this Louis Vuitton boat like purse. And that purse it looks silly, it looks campy, but Jennifer Tilly's camp, like, she's very much has a camp style to her, similar to, really similar to Sutton, except for her style, in my opinion, is a little bit better than Sutton's, because her quirky personality is more in your face, I think is why it works. And we kind of knew, we all know Jennifer Tilly, like, we've known her for years, but anyway, before this show, and anyway, so I call this out because everyone's just kind of like, ooh, that's neat, that's cute. But Erica, if Erica is a pocket watcher, and one thing that I do get weird enjoyment from when it comes to Erica or confessionals, because of the fact that she used to have it like that, now she don't. So when she be coveted after people's things and she be knowing the prices, it be cracking me up. Like, that is one of my favorite things when it comes to Erica confessional, because she's like, I know how much that is. And I really want it. I'm coveting the hell out of what she got going on right now. And I see her bag that she has with it. I want it. And of course, in her Erica way, like, I want it. And then she even, like, you even saw, like, it kind of fell through her bones, like, oh. Like, Erica. If you don't start scissoring to get what you want. She wants to be a sugar mama so bad. She wants to be a sugar baby so bad still, and I love it. I mean, it's messed up because of what happened, but if you were to separate all that from her on this show and on this show only, and especially the way she's been showing the past, last season and this season, child, Erica cracks me up. it just is what it is for me. I have to separate it. I can't think of it as one-dimensional, because if I did, I wouldn't even watch this show, honestly, because half the girls here, you know, when it comes to Housewives, a lot of the girls' morals are a little questionable. So you have to kind of insert, to a certain extent, you almost have to separate it so you can just enjoy the person for what they are in the show, and that's it. Anyway, moving on. So then they're in the, they're in the Sprinter van, and they're playing a bunch of games. And one of the games they started playing is a lot of questions about sex. And one of the questions was famous people that people have dated. And we find out that Garcelle dated Eddie Murphy, which we knew about that. She dated Will Smith, which we also knew about that. I'm surprised Jamie Foxx didn't come up, because we all knew she dated him briefly. And then she also dated Sean Penn. That we didn't know. And I want her to elaborate more on that, but we didn't get to that point. So then the next question was, how many people have slept with guys with small ping? And it was all a drinking game. How many of us have slept with someone with a crooked? And a lot of them drink to that. For those who never have, anyway, they arrive. I had to do a side note there. But they do arrive at the resort situation, and they're greeted by a Tom Cruise impersonator, because it turns out this is a place where Top Gun was filmed at, where they're staying at. And that's pretty much what happens here. And then once they get there, the girls get settled in and head to the beach. And again, we have Kyle narrating, and she just sounds really unhappy and miserable while, and they head to the beach. And the reason why I said that Kyle sounds unhappy and miserable when it comes to this is because she literally is criticizing how nice, and how much time Kathy put together for this trip. And like how it's furnished and everything, she's finding a way to complain about it. Like, and if she's not complaining about it, I don't know what this is, because it really sounds like she's complaining. I'm just saying. And then from there, we then see the girls do start going to play a game. Well, before they go to play a game, they have like a little bit of a lunch, and Bose and Dorit are talking. And Dorit is basically opening up more to Bose when it comes about what's going on with her divorce because Bose asked about it. And as this is happening and as it's occurring, and we're finding out, she hasn't talked to PK at all. So things are not going well at all. So once that last scene where we saw Dorit and PK talking and she was like, okay, so you're not going to talk to me 5 times a day anymore, that's fine. He cut off all communication. So now it's awkward because she kind of had a little bit of a nervous breakdown on the way to the trip. Because y'all already know, Dorit don't play when it comes to her kids. Especially after the robbery. Dorit, yes, she's extra when it comes to that, but I get it because she don't play about that. And so now she's having her nanny do all this extra stuff, which of course probably costs extra money to mask the fact that her and PK are separated because the kids still don't know. Because of the fact that PK will not communicate with her about the arrangements when it comes to the apartment stuff. Like, Dorit doesn't even know where he lives. And she found out from someone else that he got a place. Which is a polar opposite of how things are happening with Kyle and Mo. And Dorit, girl, I will get you an attorney ASAP. Because for someone, PK's character to me, and if y'all didn't even know this before, I already thought this even before they were separating. Because I even have thoughts when it comes to that robbery. I think I mentioned it in my video last season. I really do think Dorit didn't know. Allegedly, I do feel like PK has some issues with his money because his money was funny and he possibly allegedly staged this. But I think he staged it thinking that Dorit was not going to be home with the kids because he doesn't have communication with Dorit and the kids as we're finding out this season. He doesn't seem to care about all that. And I think it was a scheme that he put together to give us a BS, but Dorit didn't know about it. Because if Dorit knew about it, I don't think Dorit knew about it because I don't think Dorit's a good actress. I don't think she would fake that. And I feel like other people have thought that too, but I'm just going to say it because I think it's really, really trash that PK is being very, very selfish, very, very self-absorbed. But we knew this about him because he was ignoring his kids all last season, staying in London for months and months and months on end when he has little kids and leaving all the responsibility of taking care of the children to Dorit. So Dorit has been moving and acting like a single parent for about 2 years now, at least, 2 seasons now. Yeah, that is what we're seeing. And I don't know why we're not addressing that. But I also think that the reason why we're not addressing it, because it's now coming out that this was happening this season. It's now coming out that's what was happening. We didn't know that because up until this season, Dorit was basically covering for him because that's her husband. But now that they're separated, I hope that Dorit gets to the point where she gets the strength to quit this hopeful BS because there's no hope. He is doing her dirty. And I kind of was infuriated hearing that it was on her to come up with all these things when the dad is right there. The dad is in the same freaking city. Why is this up to Dorit to do all this and you can't step up and do what you need to do? That's not okay. So the reason why I have a little bit more of a soft side towards Dorit this season, I ain't gonna hold you, has a lot to do with my dislike for PK and his behavior. It's trash. It's basula. I feel bad for the kids. It's really more or less because I feel bad for the kids. It's not even really completely a Dorit thing. I think it's more of a kids thing, in my opinion. It's like, you're doing all this stuff. You're being really, really selfish. And I'm kind of just continuing off where I left off in the last episode, where you had PK complaining about, sorry, I'm some chapstick. you had PK complaining about how, like, he doesn't have his Bonnie to his Clyde anymore forgetting that they have small little ones at home. It's like, playtime's over. You need to be a parent. Instead of having the nanny take care of the daddy situation. And that's, I guess, what that's also what kind of softens both for Dorit, because she does at least have a nanny. But guess what? A nanny costs money. Money that y'all are, the money that's already funny money. Let's be real here, okay? Sorry, I got off on a soapbox from hell here. From hell. Because of Bose and Dorit talking. But needless to say, they're having their own side conversation. And Dorit is basically recapping the conversation she had with Erica. And that's how I got here with this rant. And then as this is happening, Maely Garcelle is kind of bothered that this is not a conversation for the whole table. Girl, it doesn't need to be a conversation for a whole table. This is what's going on with Dorit. Dorit and you don't even fool with each other like that. So what sense does it make, do you think, that Dorit would talk to you, want to talk to the whole table about this? And she also doesn't fool with Kyle. So she's going to bare her vulnerable soul to two people that she ain't effing with right now? Girl, if you don't get for real with that, I would, girl, be for real. Be for real. I will say this. Erica does chime in on their side and kind of like, hey, she's just talking about her divorce. Things are not going the way they should be going right now. I'll leave it to her to open up and talk more about it. And then this is where we have, you know, sudden kind of saying, no, this is, it's just not easy. Divorces are not easy. And then even Erica kind of chimes in about how these men can just get people. It just brings out the ugliness of people. And of course, Erica attests to that. She's like, it definitely does. You know, it brings out the ugliness out of you. And there were just some things going on when it came to our divorce that Erica wanted to say what happened, but she's like, I don't even want to talk about it. I don't even want to repeat it. It was that bad. And honestly, when it came to Tom and her situation, considering the fact that his morals weren't, he didn't have any morals, I believe it. I know a lot of us don't want to like Erica because of the way she was being treated. But like, that dynamic was not a good dynamic for Erica either. Let's be real. Even though, yes, she reaped the benefits of the lifestyle, but we are seeing, even when it comes to this year, just because you reap the benefits of the lifestyle does not outweigh some of the messed up things that could have been happening for you to have that lifestyle. With all the cases that are going on right now, let's be for real. I mean, that two things can be true. Yes, Erica has some vileness about her, and she still kind of does. But do you think that just was self-manufactured? There's probably stuff going on in the home that wasn't to her liking, but what was she going to do? You know? And I'm not trying to be an apologist, because I don't think, child, it can never be me when it comes to a lot of this stuff. So that's not what we're doing here. But some people have a price, and that's what it is. But anyway, I just found it interesting that Erica, you know, kind of unveiled a little bit when it came to this conversation. Because in the odd way, this is one of the only franchises, because we just had this conversation on Monday, right, when it came to Potomac. But this franchise particular, none of them are married. None of them are married. Two of them are legally married, but they're going through separation. Everyone else's are divorcees. Everybody else on the show. So they all are just kind of like putting in their two cents about it. And I love that they all did that, because they did kind of, Garcelle kind of had to like go on mute a little bit there, because I was like, Garcelle, I know you don't like to read, but you need to know how to read the room. Okay? This was not the time for you to all of a sudden think you're going to like do something. Respectfully. I mean, Your issue with Dorit has nothing to do with her relationship with PK and the parents and stuff. Your issues with Dorit is your issues with Dorit and Dorit only. Like, the math needs to math a little bit. I'm just saying. But then after that, we do see that Jennifer Tilly then also opens up about her relationship, her divorce, and how tough it was for her also. And how many of y'all knew this? Because I did not. I did not. Did y'all know that she was related to the creator of The Simpsons? I did not know that Jennifer Tilly was related to, was married to the creator of The Simpsons. I only knew Jennifer Tilly for her own work because she's a very distinctive voice. I never knew she was married to the creator of The Simpsons. So in the divorce, she got shares of The Simpsons. But this, and this divorce clearly happened, like, I think in the 90s or something like that, possibly. I don't know. But it was a long time ago. And The Simpsons are just now about to end. So basically, forever. Because The Simpsons have went on in perpetuity and it's still on air. It's still, child, I didn't even know. I was today years old when I found all that out. Anyway. Then from there, they go off to play the games, and the games are funny. Let's get into that. So they do a couple of contests. Kathy has these bobble, like these head things of Kathy Hilton everywhere. And it was like a relay race that they did on the beach. And Dorit busted her butt because that Chanel fit that she wanted to have with the hat did not work out for her at the end. Because... and she did explain in the after show, I was dressed not thinking we were going to do any activities. And then we did. And the so the pants were long enough for heels, but not long, but too long. Well, they were really long, but long for like having heels on. But too long for like not having the heels on. So she kept tripping over her pants when she was running. And it happened twice because after that game, they played Duck, Duck, Goose. And... this is the other thing that was annoying me about Kyle, because Kyle, the other ladies complained about it too. It was actually, it came off a little bit more funny about them complaining, but when Kyle complained, it just came off as naggy. So the other ladies complained like, so Kyle's complaining like, oh my gosh, what are we doing? Like, why are we like doing like these nursery rhyme games? Like, why are we stuck? Like, I feel like Kathy's just stuck in being in a nursery rhyme. And Kathy had a nice little mini clap back. She's like, you know what? I'd rather be stuck in the nursery rhyme than in real life. And it wasn't really a clap back. It was more like just kind of an observation. And I'm just kind of like, you know, in a weird way, it was kind of like her way of saying, I know I have fun. You should try sometimes. That's how I read it. I read it in, I know how to have fun. Maybe you should try that because you clearly don't. That's how I got it. At least that would have been my clapback. I don't know. But anyway, after that, the girls separate. Bose talks to her daughter. Her daughter is gorgeous, by the way. Recapping what happened. And then we have Garcelle, Sutton, and Jennifer discussing what happened at lunch. And really, Garcelle's the one who's mainly bothered about it, about why is it that, like, Dorit and Bose was having a side conversation. And the way Garcelle tries to spin it, she's like, I want to get to know Bose too. Which, I get that, but that's not what they were talking about. They were talking about Dorit and stuff because they already met and had interaction with each other. And I think Garcelle is seeing it as that Dorit is hijacking Bose. And I don't think that's what it is. I think Dorit is desperately trying to get some allies on the show, to be honest, because now a lot of the girls mess with her. I mean, that's true. From a strategic standpoint, it will make sense for her to make sure she doesn't get iced out to have some friends. So... and we know that she already knows that she doesn't have Kyle on her side anymore, so she needs someone else. Is that right? Not really, but we kind of see what's happening here. So that's part of, I think, what's going on and part of the reason why that Garcelle is annoyed, because I think Garcelle is questioning Dorit's genuine reason of wanting to befriend Bose. But we all are. Garcelle, sit back. You're not the only one. Give it time. A snake will always expose itself at some point. You don't have to worry about it. Okay? But scoot back. Work on the timing a little bit. Anyway, so they do go out to dinner. And then this is where things happen, where we have Kyle versus Dorit yet again. And then this is where Kyle continues to reach. And then she brings up the Teddy comment. And then Alexander Rogers appears on our screen again. Hi, Alexander Rogers. I watch your reviews. Love them. And then we also have the text message. And Dorit is just like, it's funny that you keep saying all the things that are bothering you, but you're not letting me say what bothers me. And we're going to do that today. And it doesn't end well. This is where it ends, it to be continued. Overall, this was a really, really good episode. But again, Kyle, I'm so sick of these antics. And I feel like I'm speaking for a lot of us. I'm sick of the antics. Get some self-awareness to you. Stop it, okay? And everyone, as all this argument's happening, everyone's head's down like, oh my God, no. But because they wanted to actually have a decent dinner, I feel like, and it did not go that way because Dorit was like, nope, you're bringing it up. Let's get to it. Because Kyle's the one who brought it up, honestly. And as soon as Kyle brought it up, Dorit's like, yep, it's my time. Let's get to it. Anyway, but that does conclude the review for The Real Housewives of Beverly Hills. I almost said Orange County. Child, y'all can tell I miss Orange County. But anyway, it does conclude the episode. It was a good episode. I did enjoy it. Let me know what you thought about it, though. Please like, comment, subscribe to the channel if you get anything out of the content. It's your girl, Sharon, a.k.a. The Mel Nostalgic Runner. And I will see you next time. Bye.